Let me thank the organizers for inviting me. It's a fantastic venue. I was last here at SAMPT 2000 and something. I can't remember exactly what. But I really enjoyed that, so I'm really looking forward to this meeting. And the Buer Bays last night was superb. It's the main reason to come here, really, I would say. So I was just staring at the name of the conference also, and interactions between low complexity data models and sensing systems, that could be this talk. So I was quite pleased that it seemed like a good fit. Okay, I want to talk really about some recent work that I've done with my now ex postdoc Mohammed Golbabi on extending the range of iterative gradient projection techniques to consider what happens when you have inaccuracies. And this is motivated by an interesting data-driven sensing problem that I will also talk about called magnetic resonance fingerprinting. And that work has been done in conjunction with Yves Wheel's group in Heriot-Watt University, and Ian Marshall is in medical physics in the University of Edinburgh, that deals with all the actual sensing. Okay, so let's begin. I'm going to consider a generalized compressed sensing problem. So I'm shamelessly going to drop straight into finite dimensions. So I apologize to all of you who don't like doing that. We're going to assume that we're in finite dimensions, so we've got some finite dimensional approximation. We're doing some sampling, but we're in a situation where we don't have enough time or ability to collect the sufficient measurements. So the question is, how are we going to acquire X from Y, and what information can we use? So this of course is the in classic compressed sensing would be, I would assume that X is sparse or it's sparse in some transfer domain. We're going to look at essentially a generalization of that. Okay. So I'm particularly interested in general constraint sets. So I'm going to assume that X belongs to some set, not yet defined. It's typically going to be low dimensional. So in the same spirit as standard compressed sensing, I'm going to want that it somehow constrains my dimension. And we are simply going to look at solving a constrained least squares problem. So that is, I observe Y, which is some noisy approximation of AX, and I'm going to insist that I try and minimize my data fidelity term subject to some low dimensional constraint defined by my model. Now, of course, we can show under relatively benign scenarios that works if your model is sufficiently informative and can solve this. But in general, this is an NP-hard problem. So, if you have sparsity, in general, you can't expect to always solve this unless you have nice properties of A. And so we'll be discussing that as we go along. In terms of practical reconstruction, I'm going to use something that's incredibly simple and yet pretty effective, which is iterative gradient projection, also known as the projected Landweber algorithm. So essentially, what we're going to do is, so in terms of this picture, this is my ambient signal space. These are my observations down here. I want my A to, in some sense, capture the information of the signal set of interest in my measurements, and I'm doing some nonlinear approximation. And we do that via First, we calculate a gradient. So we start off with an initial guess, typically zero. We calculate a gradient to try and reduce the data fidelity term. And then once we've taken a step in that gradient with a step size mu, we project onto my constraint set C. Now, I should stress that I am particularly interested in scenarios where C is going to be non-convex. So this is not it's not necessarily a nice, easy, sort of iterative soft thresholding scenario. Okay, so P is going to be the Euclidean projection, so the ortho projection, onto the constraint set C. Okay, so we said that there are some conditions for this to work. We need to have some form of stability, and typically in following the sort of compressed sensing framework, we want some form of embedding of the signal set of interest in my observation space. More than that, I would like it to in some way be stable and robust. So we're going to look at a Bielitschitz embedding, which means that when I apply A to pairs of points x and x prime in my set C, neither shrinks nor expands that distance too much. So I want to be able to control that with alpha and beta. So this is nothing more than a generalization of the restricted isometry property to arbitrary low-dimensional sets. And the projected gradient algorithm, going back to sparsity, is nothing more than a generalization of iterative hard thresholding. Okay, so my ex-student, Thomas Blütensat, produced a very nice work back in 2011 showing that basically if A and C satisfy this property, so this generalized RIP, and moreover that B is less than 1.5 alpha, so this is controlling exactly how stable the solution is, then iterative projected gradient converges. It converges at a linear rate, so we typically need an order of, to control the error here, we typically need an order of log tau to the minus one iteration. So it's nice, it's fast, and stable. Obviously, we require these conditions, and that doesn't necessarily come for free, but this is where we sort of lean on the results from compressed sensing, the sort of Johnson-Linden-Strauss theorem, where you say that if I've got data points, then I know how big a dimension I'm expecting, so how big M has to be in terms of getting a stable embedding of that. In 2006, Sarlos generalized this to arbitrary affine subspaces. We also did union of subspace models. This is extended to low rank, smooth manifolds, etc. So there's a very general setting, and the take-home message really is as long as, in some sense, the measurement dimension M is of the order of the dimension of the intrinsic set, then I can achieve this this stable embedding with appropriate measurement. So that's the important thing to think about. Okay, so as I said, this is really just looking at generalizations of compressed sensing. So I thought I'd give a nice introduction to this, telling you all stuff that you I'm sure already know, given that it's the first talk in the morning and we started quite early. So we've gone from sparsity. We can also consider structured sparsity, analysis sparsity, low rank, manifolds, etc. And what I want to talk about today is more data-driven models. But interestingly, data-driven models that come from physics. So we're going to be looking at putting physical constraints on our measurements to allow us to solve the inverse problem. Okay, so this all sounds great. We can all go home, it's done, fantastic. Well, that's not quite true. There are, of course, some problems. First of all, it might be that this is too expensive. If we're in very large dimensions, it might be that calculating the gradient is expensive, or maybe we can't exactly calculate it. I'm going to concentrate less on the gradient aspect. More interestingly is the projection. So I've just glossed over the fact that if I go back, the analysis sparsity model, for example, can be super non-trivial. It might be that projection, just a simple projection onto that, could be NP-hard. So it's not immediately clear that this on paper simple algorithm is actually easy to code up on a computer. So I might really struggle to be able to produce this approximation. Sometimes it might require auxiliary optimization, so iterations. One might think about things like intersections of models and that sort of thing. But what I'm interested in today is not one where it's necessarily impossible, but where it's just pretty expensive. So imagine that C is defined by data. So I give you data that actually constrains my my signal model. I want my signal to live in a set of data. Then approximating the projection onto this may require some exhaustive test of the data, and we're going to see a nice example of that. So what I would want to do is somehow be able to speed this up. It's also worth pointing out that if I'm doing a data-driven projection, if that data is sort of trying to capture an underlying physics, I'm already approximating my constraint set. So that raises the question, to what extent is this iterative projector gradient robust to inexact or approximate oracles? If I replace the projection operator by an approximate projection, if I replace the gradient by an approximate gradient, can I still expect this to give me reasonable results that may be moderated slightly by the level of approximation, or is the thing gonna blow up and go wrong? Okay, so that's the first section of the talk where I wanted to sort of set the scene of what we want to talk about. So now I'm going to take a shift, so you now all need to wake up again. And I'm going to talk about a motivating application. So I didn't come onto this task that we're looking at purely from a mathematical interest. This was genuinely driven by looking at a sensing problem that we were trying to solve and trying to speed up. And this question arises naturally. So let me just describe that to you, which I think is very much of independent interest. Anyone who does MRI will either have heard of this or certainly seen it in the literature. It's becoming a very popular novel technique. So what is magnetic resonance fingerprinting? Magnetic resonance fingerprinting is a compressed sensing inspired imaging modality that is aiming at achieving quantitative MRI. So let me step back and say, what is quantitative MRI? Well, traditional MRI, although we see it in hospitals and they use it for diagnosis, traditional MRI is not quantitative. It is a qualitative imaging modality. So unlike, for example, CT, you go in, you have your x-rays taken, and they tell you what the Hounsfield units of the image are. So that's a quantified value of what they're measuring. MRI, you typically go in and the way MRI imaging works, and apologies for anyone who really understands the physics, because I certainly don't, it's an active imaging system. You put someone in a magnetic field. You hit them with RF pulses, and that excites the spins of the protons. And so you get all your magnetization aligns along the z-axis. You hit with an RF pulse, and that excites these things in the transverse plane. and they spin around at a particular frequency, and then they decay. And they decay both in the transverse domain, and then they also process back to the vertical domain. And the rates at which they do this are called T1 and T2. These are the relaxation times. And so this is, or in MR speak, spin lattice and spin. And these control the physics. So these are controlled by the properties of the material that you're imaging. So these can be considered as true physical quantities, like Hounsfield units in X-rays. These are the physical quantities associated with MR. But typically, when you have an MR image, you get something like what's called a T1 weighted image or a T2 weighted image, where the sequence that has been constructed, and typically you're hit by a sequence of RF pulses. This is designed to accentuate T1 type aspects of an image of the material, or T2 type aspects of the material. So you'll get different types of images. So you can see up here that T1, if that's right, sorry, my eyesight's not good enough. Yeah, I think that's T1. Is a slightly different picture to T2. So you're getting some sort of combination of these, and this is the proton density, so that's the sort of intensity one expects to get of the image. In a standard MR image, you're just getting a qualitative picture, very much like the picture that you get on your mobile phone camera. It's not quantifying the number of photons or the luminescence. It's pretty, it's useful, but it's not physics. So quantitative imaging, or quantitative MRI, aims at actually quantifying these properties. So can I go and calculate these properties exactly for a given patient? And one can extend this to many other physical quantities as well. So why would I want to do that? Well, obviously, if I scan a patient on one scanner and then move over to another scanner, if I want to be able to compare this data, I want some sort of baseline with which to do this. And if I'm measuring quantitative parameters, I can do that. Otherwise, there's going to be some unknown calibration between the two that I need to worry about. So quantitative imaging is very popular in MR. It's a very active research field. There's lots of opportunities for improved diagnosis and stuff if you have quantitative parameters. However, the standard approach is incredibly slow. What do we do? Well, as I said, these are relaxation times typically. So the naive approach, which is certainly one that is still used as the gold standard, is you would excite the patient with an RF pulse. You then wait. You then record the magnetization response, and you form an image. You then wait till the magnetization has relaxed back to equilibrium, and you repeat. And you do it again, and again, and again. And then, per voxel, you plot the magnetization response, and you try and fit an exponential curve. So this is great. We can do physical experiments, but it is shockingly slow. I mean, this can be 35, 45 minutes, far too slow for clinical practice. So this is not really used. And people have been looking over the years at how you can do clever tricks to speed this up. And that's where magnetic resonance fingerprinting comes in. It's aiming to collect all these and you do this typically per parameter. So you do an experiment to calculate T1, and then you repeat the whole thing again to calculate T2. So MR fingerprinting, the idea which I feel is incredibly appealing as a sensing framework, is to try and collect all the parameters in a single scan, single acquisition. And how do you do it? Well, what you need to do is excite the material sufficiently that it conveys information about all the parameters at each pulse. There's no reason to wait for everything to fall back down to equilibrium as long as you understand what you've done in the past. So in theory, you can run this as a single acquisition where, I'm not going to say too much about these pictures. These come from the original MRF paper in Nature 2013. Essentially, there's this thing called flip angle. So I said that your magnetization is usually equilibrium is in the vertical, in the Z direction, and you hit it with an RF pulse that pulls it down towards the transverse plane. That's called the flip angle. How much you pull it down is called the flip angle. You can also vary the timing between RF pulses, though interestingly that now today seems to be not so relevant. So we'll typically focus on this. If I've got a sequence of flip angles, so it's flipping this thing back and forth, so I'm continuously exciting the tissue. I now need to acquire sufficient measurements, but only enough. I don't need to take more measurements than I need. So every time I hit the patient with an RF pulse, I then take some measurements. In the original MRF paper, they perform a rapid spiral measurement set of K-space. So I should have said at the beginning, MRI images in the spatial Fourier transform of the material of the patient, and you typically either scan that using Cartesian. You can do rapid scans using spiral, and this is very much where compressed sensing originally sat in MRI, is how do you undersample K-space and still exploit the spatial information to reconstruct. Here we're doing a sequence of pulses. Between each pulse, we collect some Fourier data. We can then back project each of these images per pulse, and you get an image that looks something like this. So I think you'll agree this is a pretty lousy image. It's far more distorted than you would get in if you back projected, images that we traditionally enhance with sparsity based methods or compressed sensing based methods. So really, you've lost all the information. But the key point is that I don't have one of these. I have typically about 1,000 of these. Okay, but in terms of the scan, this is very rapid because I should say each of these RF pulses is occurring every 10, 20, 30 milliseconds. So it's a very rapid sequence of information. And so, okay, that's the excitation. We've talked about the back projection and the measurements. What's the final ingredient of magnetic resonance fingerprinting? It's to fit the data to the physics. So how do we do that? We know if you give me a particular material with a particular T1 and T2 relaxation, I can look at the physical model. The physics is described by a set of ordinary differential equations called the Bloch equations on a macroscopic scale. And I can solve these ODEs for the particular excitation sequence, and I will get a response. So that is any quantum material has a certain response. So for example, here in red, we are seeing one such response associated with the excitation. And what the guys who proposed MRF did is said, well, if I now look, so forget this is an image. Forget this is an image stack. Look at it along the stack. So each voxel now becomes a time series. Now that time series is very noisy due to the spatial aliasing that we're seeing. So instead of getting a nice clean response like the red curve, you will get a response like the blue curve. However, if you do this, if this excitation is rich enough, and if the response is distinguishing enough, if I have a bunch of these responses and I correlate all these responses to this signal and choose the one that correlates best, that will give me a good prediction or a reasonable prediction of my T1 and T2. And that's what they did. And then they produce a map that comes like this. So although it looks horrible here, when you actually do this, you get pretty accurate maps coming out of the correlation. Okay, so I think it's a really nice idea in terms of not worrying about sort of classical letting magnetization relax back to equilibrium before taking new measurements. This is more just saying take the measurements and sort out what you've done afterwards in the reconstruction. So very much sort of computational imaging problem. Of course, this the fact that we've got to build this dictionary of responses is going to be a bottleneck. It's going to be an approximation, and it's also going to be expensive. So in the original paper, the dictionary they used had about 500,000 atoms or dictionary elements. So each voxel sequence has to be correlated with 500,000 atoms, choosing the largest one and then moving on to the next. So this is not a fast fast process. Okay, so I should have put that up. This is the block equation, so we can consider this as a continuous model, but we're going to discretize it. We discretize it by building essentially what, from a signal processing perspective, are match filters, and then we're going to correlate those. But the dictionaries can be large. Okay. That was the proposed idea. There was the original paper, so I came across this in, I think it was 2013. The original paper proposed this as a as being related or inspired by compressed sensing, but the actual links were not drawn. So along with colleagues in EPFL and Yves Weil, who's now at Heriot-Watt University, we set about trying to put this into a generalized compressed sensing framework. So I'm hopefully going to convince you that this is a generalized compressed sensing framework. We're going to assume that we have a multi-dimensional data cube. So that is, remember, that's my image stack, image sequence, as a function of time. And each voxel or voxel sequence is going to behave as some specific response. So this is my signal model. So my signal model can actually be viewed as a product model over all my voxels. I'm not imposing at this stage any spatial structure. So this is the fundamental thing that's different, say, from classical compressed sensing in as used in MRI, where typically you're exploiting spatial or spatial-temporal information. Here we are just using temporal information. But as an aside, let me say that because that temporal information is physics-driven, it's actually really a strong prior. And that, in my experience, makes a much bigger difference than, say, a soft prior like spatial sparsity. Okay, so we're going to introduce our linear operator. Our linear operator is simply that at each time instant L, I'm measuring my Fourier coefficients, and then I'm subsampling them. So I'm choosing either a spiral or some other subsampling approach. So I have y equals ax, and I can pose this as a simple physics-driven inverse problem. I want to minimize my data fidelity, as we described at the beginning, subject to the constraint model. However, the constraint model, so although we don't have sparsity here, we still have a combinatorics thing. Our constraint model is a product model, and so to actually solve this, I need to, if I were to do this exhaustively, so if I were to look at each one of these that the best fits, there are p to the d number of elements in my, so if my dictionary was 500,000, now I'm doing, which is that p, so p is 500,000 and d is the number of voxels. So this is clearly a combinatorial explosion. We don't want to try and calculate this. But we can go to iterative projected gradient to the rescue. So here we're going to replace a direct solution by a simple gradient projection solution. Why do we want to do this? Because so although we could have solved the other one exhaustively, here now when we do a gradient step, because our model is a product model, the projection operator separates per voxel. So now all I need to do per voxel is a nearest neighbor projection onto my set of response signals. So I do a gradient step as before, and then per voxel I say which of these response sequences best fits the data. This also has a very nice interpretation that a single iteration of this is exactly the original MRF match filtering algorithm. So one can think of this as an iterative improvement on standard match filtering, but we're now solving the inverse problem rather than as the MRF paper always calls it, doing pattern matching. Okay, so our complexity is much reduced. We examine this in terms of sort of standard compressed sensing type theory and showed that we couldn't show anything for spiral, interestingly enough, but we could show that, see if this works. If I do sampling, subsampling of K-space like this, this is a uniform sequence across K-space, but randomly aligned. So this is what we would call random echo planar imaging in MRI speak. This sampling is sufficient to have an RIP, so a stable embedding, and therefore we can expect this to work. Now this is a slightly contentious point because I argue that spiral doesn't seem to have this. We're not, remember, doing any spatial modeling. All our modeling is temporal. So if I don't sample at the edges of K-space, or I don't sufficiently sample at the high frequencies, I can expect there to be ambiguities. And interestingly enough, as I say, this is contentious, so I apologize for those that don't believe this. If I do spiral, and I solve the same iterative gradient projection algorithm, I'm not sure how well this is coming out on the slide to you guys, but this is what the matched filter does, which looks relatively smooth. But if I now iterate it, so iterating it, my data fidelity drops quite dramatically, so I'm essentially got a better reconstruction. But I start to see very high frequency artifacts coming on. So I would argue that this is an RIP failure. But as I say, this is currently quite a contentious point, and spiral is by far the most popular sampling pattern in MRF, and a lot of people would argue that this is actually a problem of the algorithm rather than the acquisition. However, I think we can show that this is essentially a null space that we're vector that we're looking at, and so essentially is an intrinsic problem of spiral sampling. Anyway, that's an aside. Right, back to nearest neighbor searches. So we now have an algorithm. Let's just recap what we're doing. We do a gradient step. That's a few. There's a Fourier transform and stuff. That's not too bad. And then a set of nearest neighbor matches per voxel sequence. So how expensive is that? Well, each voxel I have to exhaustively look through my library of responses. That's pretty expensive. And worse than that, I have to iterate this typically, say, 10 times. I mean, the algorithm converges quite quickly, but that's still going to be expensive. So how do I speed this up? Well, the classical way of speeding up a nearest neighbor search is to introduce some form of tree structure. So classically, you might think of bull trees, metric trees, or KD trees, where you're essentially partitioning the data and you're not requiring to do an exhaustive search. Now, for this, the ideal model is for us is the cover tree. A cover tree, I think, are fantastic things if you've not come across them. They essentially put a hierarchy of epsilon nets on your data. So you start out with a very coarse epsilon net, you then go down to a finer cover, a finer cover, and so on. And they have really nice guaranteed properties if the data that you're doing this on is truly low dimensional. So it can live in very high ambient dimensional space, but as long as the data that you're looking at is low dimensional, and in this case, for T1 and T2, we have essentially a two-dimensional manifold. So this is what the partition looks like at different scales of the cover tree. And this means that we can search typically in log the number of atoms rather than linear the number of atoms. So this is good. This provides us with one speed up. Furthermore, tree searches are particularly good when you relax from an exact nearest neighbor search to an approximate nearest neighbor search. And there are two different ways of doing this. There's what's called a 1 minus epsilon. I'll say a bit more about this in a second. And then you have quite accurate theoretical bounds on the complexity. Or you can do fixed precision, which essentially means as you're going down your tree, you stop at some level and don't bother going to the bottom. But again, you're introducing errors. It's harder to put a useful or meaningful complexity bound on that. But again, that works quite well. And one could imagine doing a sort of combination where you do fixed precision, but you let the precision progressively get better per iteration. So these are all methods that we could consider to speed up the algorithm. Now maybe this sounds like, well, we might get a few percent here or there. Let's wait till we see the results. But in each case, as I said, this was the thing that motivated us to look at inexact iterative projective gradient, because in each case, we are now, this guy here is not an exact projection. It's an approximation, and depending on how I do it, it's going to be a different type of approximation. So that brings us to the question of, can we do this? Does it work? And how should we expect it to perform? So what we did is we went back and looked over the theory that Thomas Blumensaat developed and basically looked at how that ran when you introduce different types of approximations. So let me just detail these inexact oracles specifically. So if I have, we're not going to concentrate too much on gradient. If I have a fixed precision gradient, I am saying that there is some constant VG that I am getting to between my approximation of the gradient and the true gradient at each iteration. Similarly, for fixed precision projection, I am saying that my choice of point in my projected set and the best projection is going to be bounded again by some constant. So this picture is important here. What we're saying here is that if this is my x prime and it projects down onto this point here, I can choose any point on the set C that lies within this circle. Okay. Now, what a fixed precision says is as I now move x towards my constraint set, in some sense, it becomes easier because the size of the set C does not, the size of the set C intersected with the circle does not change. Okay, so that's what a fixed precision looks like, and it's interesting that for convex optimization, Schmidt and co authors have previously shown that you can run forward backward algorithms. Mo, is it? Yeah, forward backward algorithms with these approximate oracles, and it still converges in the convex setting. So we're looking in the non-convex setting. So let me contrast that projection with the 1 minus epsilon projection. So, okay, the gradient, we're going to do the same fixed precision, but here we're now saying that the distance between the point and its projected point, so the thing we're minimizing when we do my projection, that has to be within 1 plus epsilon of the optimal. So this is different if we now look at this picture. What we're saying is that if I'm far away, I can actually be quite slack, whereas as I get closer, my solution has to be more precise. So this automatically has some sort of variable precision built into it, but interestingly, in a number of scenarios, it is easier to form a 1 minus epsilon projection, approximate projection, than a fixed precision one. Okay, in the case we're looking at, we have the luxury that we can do either, which is quite nice. So, how long have I got? Let's look at the results. I'm not going to go through the proofs. I truly want to highlight how the results from standard gradient projection change with these inexact oracles. So let's first look at fixed precision and progressive fixed precision. In this scenario, I have exactly the same conditions on my generalized RIP. So in exactly the same settings as the exact algorithm. Convergence is linear. If rho is less than one, which is exactly the same convergence rate that we expect for the exact algorithm. And we have essentially three terms here in the error. The first term is constant, so as long as rho is less than one, this converges linearly. The second term is going to be dependent on the sum and this error, and these errors are a function of my approximation terms, and so this defines effectively a constant error that I can't get beyond. So that's saying that if I do fixed precision, I will incur an additional cost that I can't get rid of, which makes sense. I'm not doing exact projection. And then finally, this term, this is the noise term, remember. So again, here we have a noise term that is the same as the noise term in the original exact algorithm. So we're seeing that in this scenario, we actually have very little loss due to doing fixed precision approximate projection. So let me say a bit about the implications of this. This means that if I do, fixed precision, I'm basically going to run and it's going to converge to a point at the same rate as the exact, but it's going to have slightly more error. If I run progressive fixed precision, I'm going to get the same level of error as the exact, and as long as I choose R to drop quickly enough, my convergence rate is going to be the same. So if I make my approximations degrade, get finer and finer too slowly, then yes, it's going to be slower. But as long as I speed that up quickly enough, going down to a higher accuracy, I will achieve exactly the same rate as I would do in with the exact. And of course, what this is really saying is there's no point in going to an exact projection. The exact projection is just going to cost you computation, but it's going to gain you nothing in terms of performance. Okay, interestingly, the picture is quite different for the 1 plus epsilon approximation. So this is a harder one to interpret, so I'm just going to highlight a few things. Here we have a stronger RIP requirement. So that's saying that I expect 1 plus epsilon approximate projections to fail earlier than the exact projections. Secondly, down here, the convergence rate is affected, so it will converge slower. However, when it does converge, this term will eventually die, but there will be some amplification. Again, the rho comes in here, so there'll be some amplification on the noise term. So the ultimately, we can run this. It will, if it does converge, it should go down roughly to the right level with a bit more noise. But it will be slower, and the possibility of it converging will be less. I need stricter isometry properties to get that to work. Okay, so that's the theory. Let's have a look whether, you know, theory is all right in theory, but how does it perform in practice? So let's build a toy problem. So we're going to take the MRF model, i.e. this product compressed sensing model, but to make it simpler, we're going to assume that the A matrix is a random Gaussian, so that gives us a nice, we know we get nice isometry properties for that, and we're going to choose data from different manifolds. So we've tried the sort of S-curve, the spiral, and the wave manifolds, and we're going to assume that so each voxel in my product model is going to assume that it follows one of these in an ambient space of 200 dimensions, and I'm going to have a dictionary size of 5,000. So this is just a toy problem to see what happens when we run this. Do we see the properties predicted by the theory? Okay, so let's start with fixed precision. So as predicted, I run my fixed precision with different values of approximation. So this is where we're truncating our search. And we see that the convergence rate is essentially the same, but obviously once we hit the fixed precision, we get a higher error. So again, this is nice. If I'm only interested in getting an error down to here, I can use an appropriate fixed precision algorithm. If I now look at the progressive fixed precision, again, we see exactly as the theory predicted. So here we're now letting the approximation constant decay as a function of k. So as we iterate more, we are requiring the projection to get better and better. If we choose a very large value of r, still converging, it takes a long time. And you know, eventually that will converge, but it's slow. So if we look at R is 0.7, we see that it is converging, but it's slower. But this is the interesting thing. Once R becomes small enough, so R is 0.1, it's converging at the same rate as if R was zero. So we're saying that exactly as predicted, the cost of the benefit of doing an exact projection is not there if you can do an approximate projection cheaper, because that will save you computation but cost you nothing in terms of performance. Okay, let's look at the 1 plus epsilon again. I won't labor the point too much, but again, it follows as predicted. It does converge down, so this is that we've got zero error here, so the noise amplification is invisible. So it does converge down. This one will converge down eventually, but as you change epsilon, you do take a hit in terms of convergence rate. So we've got these two algorithms, or these three algorithms that are with different forms of approximation, and we can say roughly what's happening in terms of theory. Finally, remember that the 1 plus epsilon was going to cost us in terms of restricted isometry properties. It's going to require a stricter restricted isometry property. Well, here are some phase transition diagrams, and sure enough, if we look at the progressive fixed precision, so this is subsampling rate against approximation rate. So we see that changing the approximation parameter r, the recovery gap, so recovery is black is success, white is failure. We see it's invariant to the choice of r up until r becomes very, very large, as predicted by the theory. Whereas in the 1 plus epsilon, we do see that as you start to drop off epsilon, you do take a hit in terms of, so you need more measurements essentially to get success. Okay, let me just, one caveat there before I show you the final results on the MRF stuff, is that here we are looking at the number of iterations. So everything we've looked at is the number of iterations required of the projected gradient algorithm to get a certain convergence level and things like the subsampling here. But in practice, if you're doing things like cover tree nearest neighbor searches, we've got these different methods of doing them. Remember, we don't have a like-for-like comparison of the actual time complexity. So although we've got nice theory, when it comes down to how fast does this work in practice, we actually have to go and do some empirical experiments and see which one is better. Because it might be that although the fixed precision has more appealing properties, it might be that the individual approximate nearest neighbor searches are much slower, and therefore this one is better. Okay, right. So have I got 5 minutes? Yeah, cool. What is our setup? So we're looking at the multi-shot EPI sampling. So this is the sampling that I showed you that gives me a nice RIP type result. We're using, this is the flip angle sequence that is used in the standard MRF. It's actually got some randomness on top of it, though there's an interesting question as to whether that's actually plays any role whatsoever. In terms of the images, so remember we're taking a sequence of images, and this is the magnetization, the spatial map of the magnetization response as a function of time. So at the fifth pulse, the 100th pulse, 200th, 400th, and you can see that the picture changes as we go through. Of course, we don't get to measure this because this would require full sampling. And we're doing subsampling in Fourier, and this is something that the MRI guys, again, don't like because they see this and say, that looks like a terrible subsampling scheme because it's all spatially, you've got lots of nasty clear aliasing. But remember, we're not looking spatially, we're looking temporally. So temporally, our aliasing is quite nice. It's all quite sort of noise-like. But yeah, so we're gonna convert all these images using the iterative projected gradient into these outputs. And so those are the outputs we get, so that's the setting. But the question is, how does it perform in terms of speed? Okay, so here we've got the solution as the mean squared error solution of the data cube, and also the T1 error and the T2 error. Let's concentrate on this one. The other show sort of similar properties. Okay, first thing to note, if I do brute force, so this is no cover tree, no inexact searches. I have a point out here. The number of, so we're measuring the projection cost in terms of the number of inner products, that's the dominant cost that I'm having to make. And I have just under 10 to the 8 of those things. Just by introducing a fast tree is very good. That gets me to, I think it gets me to this point here, which is, we should have labeled this differently, but this is the 1 plus epsilon with epsilon 0. So this is my exact cover tree search, and we see that I've gained about an order of magnitude, which is good. But now, if I look at doing fixed precision with different fixed values or progressive fixed precision, so the fixed precision does this, as we would expect. If you use a bad approximation, you get high error, and it decreases down. So this isn't so exciting. It's not actually doing much better than the exact, except where it costs you quite highly. Similarly, the progressive fixed precision interestingly gets you better performance. Now that's, we don't have any theory to say why that is, but that's an interesting observation. But again, it doesn't really get you any speed up. But this is the interesting one. So when we do the 1 plus epsilon, so this is the one where, you know, maybe it's because we're in a setting that is benign, we're well in a setting that we have an RIP type property. So this one still works, but we are getting almost three orders of magnitude better than the brute force search. So that's 1,000 times faster than I should have done that earlier. The brute force search. So really, those are the three really interesting results. Brute force, which is what most people do slow. Doing a tree, you'd be stupid not to do some form of tree search. But doing approximate nearest neighbor searches, again, massive increase in performance. So, you know, we're not talking sort of 10 or 20%, 1,000 times faster. Okay, so finally, let me summarize, because I believe I've gone run over. We've shown that iterative gradient projection is robust to these inexact oracles. We've looked at various different choices of inexact oracles and sort of qualitatively said how that's going to affect the convergence and performance of the algorithm. We've shown it works nicely with these cover tree searches in this product space compressed sensing problem, and for MRF gives us huge speed ups in the iterative recovery. I'll stop there. Thank you. Hi. Tell me the question, I'll repeat it.
So the question is, I wanted just, can you go over your convergence results, because I was very curious, so that you have convergence to some value x0.
Yeah.
Now that x0, is it the true signal that generated the measurement, or is it one member of the intersection of the non-convex set and the measurement set?
No, it's the true x0. So if we look at this, so yeah, x0 is the true measurement set. Yes.
Okay, so the non-convex set basically makes the problem unique now.
So we're assuming that our problem has a unique. So by the assumption that we've got, where have I got it said? Let me go to here. By the assumption that we've got an RIP type thing, we have uniqueness. So it's not as unique, it's unique and stable. And X naught is the true value, though we do have noise. So that's why you can't expect this thing to go down exactly to zero. But yes, we're assuming that the model is in the ideal case uniquely represented in the measurement domain. Yeah. The last slide. Sorry? That one.
Yeah, I really don't get that.
Say again?
The NMSE, you get better than the brute force when you are
Okay, so the question is, why do we get better performance here than when we do brute force? We don't have theory for this, but I believe there are other scenarios in non-convex optimization where this sort of thing has been observed. So if we think about this, what we're essentially doing is, in the brute force case, we are doing a gradient projection, very hard projection onto the set. In the approximate nearest neighbor, that projection has been relaxed. So it's like doing a sort of progressive relaxed optimization on non-convex settings. Sometimes that can give you a closer to the better solution than doing the brute force one. That's our hand waving argument, but we don't have any theory to back that up really.
You and your other question? No.